And with that, thank you. We're so glad that you're here with us tonight. On the next slide, you'll see that this discussion around Raspberry Pi and the use of these amazing resources will be shared with you tonight by Omar Shepherd, who is a curriculum specialist in STEM and career education in Orange County in California. And as I mentioned earlier, he's also one of our community ambassadors as part of the CS for All Teachers community. So I'm going to step into the background. I'm here for any technical support that you may need, but I'm going to turn it over to the expert. So have at it, Omar. Thank you so much.
Well, I wouldn't say expert, but I definitely would say someone who is just inspired to share a little bit about the Raspberry Pi, the little computer that can. But first, let me share a little bit about myself. Thanks again, Melissa. My name is Omar Shepherd, and I do have the honor of serving as a curriculum specialist in STEM and career education. Now, one of the interesting things is we this year had a chance, in spite of the pandemic, to still put on a VEX IQ robotics competition. Now, it didn't look how it would normally, you know, with hundreds of students there at the county office competing, families there supporting their students as they're being a part of the competition. It was online and it went over 2 weeks. And it was an opportunity to see that when you create opportunity and you provide access for students to participate in meaningful, competitive robotics, as well as great programming competitions, that they'll they'll come forward and compete and showcase their resilience, showcase how they can work together, showcase how we can still have confidence in the future when we see how resilient they are. We saw teams often, multiple teams in different places and spaces, different robots, and choosing which one worked the best based upon which one was performing the best. Other teams that were able to get together, though they had to engage social distancing and wearing face masks. But in spite of it all, you were able to see what learning they were able to put forward through this pandemic, which really isn't interesting now because we're coming together to talk about the Raspberry Pi. I want to make no bones about it. I really advocated for this day for the Raspberry Pi session to be 10 days before a Pi Day. Yay. March 14th. So I definitely think it's important for us to think about this amazing tool. Now, my journey into the Raspberry Pi wasn't by happenstance. I had the honor of serving as the director for the Math and Science Grant. There we were with resources trying to figure out how can we support educators with resources and tools to help students engage in computational thinking. What might be some tools we can tap to help science and math teachers be able to integrate content? We found tools like the Arduino. We found tools like the Raspberry Pi. And after purchasing our first classroom set of Raspberry Pis, we realized that we were onto something with this amazing tool. And I had the opportunity to apply and had the honor of being accepted as a Raspberry Pi certified educator, where I had a chance to go through some training and learn the great breadth and depth this amazing tool has. Let me tell a little bit about the Raspberry Pi Foundation. It is a nonprofit from the UK. It is founded here in North America, though, really with the goal of creating more opportunities for everyone to have access to physical computing. They provide lots of free resources on their website, as well as free professional learning to help you to be able to engage with true depth and understanding and all the things you can do with the Raspberry Pi. Let's take a look at some of our goals for today, though. Today, it's really about getting to know the Raspberry Pi. We're going to explore physical computing by taking a look at some different hands-on, minds-on projects you can engage with the Raspberry Pi. We're going to have an overview of different digital making projects, as well as share an overview of various curricular connections and lesson planning opportunities. All right, let's go ahead and dive in. So, why the Raspberry Pi? Well, one of the things I think is particularly interesting is we use computers every day, whether it's a laptop, whether it's through our cell phone, or whether it's the iPad like you see here. But as you see, when you engage an iPad, while you do have a power source, while you are able to do these wonderful things, it really is a walled-off computing environment. it's not really a space where you can tap into it to really enhance or modify or do different things to the actual hardware. You're really not able to access that level of learning. One of the cool things about the Raspberry Pi is it's open for experiential learning. It has so many different ways in which you can engage the different components and the access to it to be able to do very amazing things. Now, when you're looking at the Raspberry Pi, I want you to know it really is a mini computer. I want you to take a moment to look at all the amazing things that you really have that you can engage with it. And I want you to compare to what you'd be thinking about if you were having a standard tower computer there, right? You'd have to insert your keyboard, your mouse. You've had to have access for various USB devices. You'd be able to access the internet, whether by Wi-Fi or via an Ethernet cord. You may have the ability to access or insert or install a touchscreen monitor. You'd have a power and other features, right? You're given all that right here with this Raspberry Pi. So it's an opportunity for students to see that when you're working with this, you're working with a real computer. You're working with a computer that has the walls taken off that allow you to be able to really engage it to see what are the things that you can do with this? What are some projects that you might be able to do? Now, let's take a look a little bit about the Raspberry Pi. This model of the Raspberry Pi is $35. It's about the size of a credit card, and it can be used for so many things for open-ended experiential learning. They do have a newer model of the Raspberry Pi. This one here is the 4B. So as you look at it, that $35 model will be the one with the 1 gigabyte of RAM. However, as you look at the increased capacity of the Raspberry Pi, while it may increase in cost up to about $75, you are able to have a 2 gigabyte or 4 gigabyte of RAM Raspberry Pi. In addition to that, I found something very interesting. You know, they've moved away from the older version of the USB, and they've added an addition to the USB-C. What a great way for you to be able to engage with a whole new host of components, as not only do you have the USB 2, the USB 3, but now the USB-C. In addition to taking a look at those micro HDMI ports, there are so many ways in which you can interface the Raspberry Pi with so many different technology tools that you're working with all the time, whether it's your monitors, whether it's other sensors or other microcontrollers. What a great opportunity for you to innovate. All right. So, physical computing is for everyone. It's a way for us to no longer be trapped into a screen and for students and girls in particular to be able to get more motivated as they engage in computing. Now, I want to make sure I add a few caveats. You know, I'm really excited about sharing with you about the Raspberry Pi, but today isn't about how to do a specific project. It's about open-ended learning about physical computing and how you can engage with that with the Raspberry Pi. So I encourage you to be a learner, to be thinking about how you can build your own project or create a host of projects you might be able to engage your students with later. All right. I want you to be open to thinking of every engagement with the Raspberry Pi as an opportunity to experience a first attempt in learning. We're not failing here. What we're doing is we're learning and we're growing along the way. So, one of the interesting things about the Raspberry Pi is I've been to a dozen sessions where they were putting up a Raspberry Pi as a raffle gift. You get the Pi, you're thinking to yourself, okay, this is great. I've got the Raspberry Pi. That's the credit card size device there on the left. What can I do with it? Well, the reality is you are going to need some things to be able to actually engage that Pi. And this is where you got to begin to think creative. If you're currently working at a school site, you might be thinking, gee, are there any old monitors around the school from the old computer lab? Are there any old keyboards or mice that I might be able to get, right? Because I'm going to need that to be able to engage the Raspberry Pi. Let's take a look at what we have here. You have 4 USB 2.0 ports. Gee, those might be good for a USB mouse, a USB keyboard. You've got the ability to have a gigabit Ethernet. That's interesting. Just in case you have any issues getting on the Wi-Fi, could you possibly hook it up to the Ethernet cord? you have a audio composite and video. The standard 3.5 millimeter, you know, the ability to plug in a standard set of headphones to be able to hear. You've got a camera interface. You've got the ability to have an HDMI video. That literally means if you have an HDMI monitor, you can hook up the HDMI monitor directly to the Raspberry Pi. Or if you have an older VGA monitor, you can get an adapter. And you can adapt the VGA monitor to HDMI to allow you to be able to transfer that image. However, for the audio, you would have to use a cord that went from the audio composite and video port into the audio of the actual monitor, because the HDMI here would not take over the sound. All right, let's keep going here. And then for the power, you have a mini USB. And this here is the most important part of the Raspberry Pi. This is the micro SD storage. This is the actual operating system. Without this, you would not be able to actually work with the Raspberry Pi, because you would not have an operating system for it to run on. And then you have a display serial interface. This is where you can begin to think about the different projects you can work on with the Raspberry Pi by inserting some of the different ports and peripherals. Maybe, Julie, when you were sharing about the device you were describing, it used the display serial interface or one of these other ports in order to be able to transfer the images and or make a touchscreen, because this is how you would begin to interface with the Raspberry Pi. All right, excuse me, I'm going the wrong way here. And then you have the access for Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. You have the Broadcom sponsored memory chip. In addition to that, you have the 40-pin GPIO sensor. This here is general purpose input output. This is really where the fun of working with the Raspberry Pi is. These pins are where you control different things that you may have connected to the Raspberry Pi, or different functions that you want the Raspberry Pi to execute. All right, let's go ahead and proceed. Let's say we're getting set up with the Raspberry Pi and we've got everything ready to go. We've got our power source. We've got our keyboard and mouse that we harvested from the surplus at our school from the old computer lab. We've got our parts pack. We've got an old monitor HDMI to VGA adapter for our old school monitor, right? And we are ready to go. We're gonna get our Raspberry Pi set up. So before I get going here, I'm curious, do any of you have any experience setting up a Raspberry Pi? Julie, Marcia, Yolanda? Okay. Well, I can definitely share with you, it is an exciting experience. It's very similar to setting up a standard computer. So if you've ever had to have a HDMI and a mouse and a keyboard and the related devices, then the actual thing that you would have to do, I'm sorry, I'm distracted here, I had my doorbell ring. Then what you would have to do is simply just connect them, similar to how you would a standard computer. All right, let's look at this here. There is something I want to make sure I make you aware of, and that is the proper orientation of the micro SD card. The micro SD card is where you're going to be installing the operating system that we shared, right? So if you don't have this installed properly, this is where you'll have a challenge with not being able to operate the Raspberry Pi. You'll plug it up and cut it on and nothing will happen. So by putting it in properly and making sure you avoid breaking it, you want to make sure you're gentle with it. You can make sure you have a successful experience once you get everything connected. So this graphic here is just to walk you through how you would properly orient everything for its proper installation with the Raspberry Pi. You'd have your USB installed, your HDMI, your micro USB for your power. And this would be how you would ensure that you would have everything oriented properly. Let's pause for a minute though. I know we're talking about this as we're thinking about, gee, we're gonna put this together. We're gonna have it all set up. But let's think about what are some things we want to consider if we were in the classroom. We're going to talk a little bit later about some remote applications, right? This is where teamwork, pairing students together, giving students defined roles of who's going to do what, right, really becomes critical, because these are fine components that you don't want to be damaged if students aren't working well together, you know. Or these are things you have to think about. Do we want to have individual students with individual setups in order for them to be able to engage? Do you have any thoughts on that, on how you would organize that in your classroom?
Omar, I muted myself because I had some Raspberry Pis in the classroom and thought it would be great to get some wireless mice. And I would caution anybody with middle schoolers, don't do that. Wow. Because we spent more days with those dongles trying to figure out, okay, everybody unplug everyone and let's see which mouse this this belongs to. So that was a lesson learned, and wow, would never do that again.
Thank you for that. That is really, really a great point. And I definitely know I have had a similar experience. And unfortunately, while I was able to figure out a solution, it was far too late. The solution I came up with after the fact was renaming each of them when you plug them in. So therefore, I would rename the USB that was recognized. So therefore, I would plug them into my standard computer, and then I would rename it there. And then when I plugged it back into the Raspberry Pi, it had retained that name. I had those little micro, keyboards that had a built-in mouse pad on it. And it was interesting, but I definitely concur. Thanks for sharing that. All right. Let's go ahead and proceed here. So therefore, going back to that then, one of the things I thought about was the orientation of the cords. Will students be able to plug them up in their groups the proper way without people tripping over things, right? So therefore, I ended up having tables put around the room, right? Imagine a rectangular style. All the students are behind those tables. We have the center space where we had the monitor, we had the Pi, and then behind it, we zip tied cords into several surge protectors that we had on the floor. So it kind of created a little bit of chaos in the sense that everyone was around the room in the perimeter, but it created order by ensuring that folks weren't tripping and we didn't have anything hazardous to concern ourselves with that. They were able to focus on the project and not have to worry about tripping, et cetera, et cetera. All right, let's go ahead and proceed. Pencil boxes, plastic were a great storage solution. That's awesome. That's awesome. So let's look at this here. We plugged everything up. We got our Pi going. Everything's connected. We plugged it in. And what are we going to see? We should see this rainbow screen here. Raspbian, the name of the software program that the Raspberry Pi uses, will take you through a series of images, right? If you see these raspberries, that's a good sign, right? And then you'll be welcome to the Raspberry Pi desktop. Now, I want you to know that one of the most fascinating things for me, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you, everyone, was when I got on the Raspberry Pi, seeing if I could get on YouTube. I was. However, we could do so much more. The reality was, once we discovered the possibilities of the Pi, it really created endless exploration. One of the things I do want to make sure I share with you is, as you think about getting onto the Pi, think about the different software applications, right? You may be thinking about Wi-Fi versus built-in applications. Some districts may not want you to have your Raspberry Pi on the Wi-Fi due to its open source nature, right? How can you find some workarounds with that? Well, one workaround we found in my classroom was me using my own personal hotspot, right? I cut it on. I could have up to 10 devices. That's up to 10 Pis. That was basically for up to 30 students, you know, in that moment. But I found the reality was, most of the projects that we were going to engage in did not require for us to be on Wi-Fi. It just required for us to have everything that we needed to be downloaded or activated on the Pi, right? That was the main thing we needed. All right. So let's pretend we have our Raspberry Pi active. Everything is downloaded and it's now coding time, right? So for those of you that may be thinking, gee, I don't know how we'll integrate the Raspberry Pi on my campus. One of the cool things the Raspberry Pi Foundation does is promote and support code clubs, right? While you don't have to have a Raspberry Pi to start a code club, it is a great way to bring the two together. So let's just say it's now time to engage in some programming. Scratch, I'll go back here. As you see here, when we explore the desktop of the Raspberry Pi, here's a host of the programs that you'll see there. I'm sorry, Marsha, did you have a question? You want to share something? You have a host of programs there, right? You see programming, you see Office, the internet, right? Python, you see Scratch, right? You see Scratch 2. So this gives you a sense of some of the built-in applications within the program in order for you to be able to engage the Raspberry Pi that don't require for you to be on the internet, right? This is what's already embedded on that micro SD card when you install it. All right, let's proceed. So with that being shared, it's coding time. And you're now going to have your students engage in a programming activity utilizing Scratch. Now, students that already utilize Scratch, you may be able to skip this introductory lesson. I'll be honest. However, for students that may not have a lot of experience working with Scratch, this can be a great opportunity for them to really develop some understanding of the platform, right? So what we see here is on the slide, you're offered a lot of instruction as it relates to the Scratch platform. Students can be oriented to understand what they're seeing when they're given the different options on Scratch, as it relates to the stage, as it relates to the character that they'll be interacting with, or different objects on the screen being referred to as sprites, right? As they're able to understand about where to drag different blocks to navigate and work with their code. Now I know we're up to Scratch 3 in the actual online version. The Raspberry Pi has Scratch 1 and Scratch 2. So let's just say now that you've introduced your students to Scratch, you've now given them a chance to engage in an actual lesson. Now here's an example of what that might look like. So this here is the Lost in Space project on the Raspberry Pi website. As you see here, it opens up in Scratch 3, right? So if you were engaging this outside of the Raspberry Pi space, you would go through the Scratch 2 version, right? And that's how you'd be able to see what it would look like on the Raspberry Pi. For those of you that may have an interest in seeing what this looks like, I will drop a link in the chat to this project here, which is called Lost in Space. Basically, an introduction. You're going to learn how to program your own animation. Click on the flag to see the animation. So we click on the flag. In this animation here, the main thing you notice is this rocket ship getting smaller in size as it reaches closer to Earth, right? And it gets smaller and smaller as it reaches to Earth. By and large, everything else on this here stays the same. So they are creating a program where when this rock hits the edge, it bounces to another area. They're creating the program where this little character or whatever character they choose is going in circles, where the star is getting bigger and smaller, right? So there aren't very many programming elements. However, it guides them through it. What they'll need, what they'll learn, animate a sprite using a loop, change the appearance, right? So I'm curious, for those of you that may already be engaging your students in Scratch, be thinking about as you begin to engage them with the Raspberry Pi and Scratch, where we're going to go next, if this is something you'd want to go ahead and have them engage in. All right, let's take a look at why. All right, now that our students have engaged in this lost in space activity, hey, did your program work? You know, did it do as you thought it would do the first time? Hey, give us some feedback, you know? And this is a way we can really begin to go into greater depth with the Raspberry Pi. We've built the Raspberry Pi, we've got the Pi online, we've accessed some of the programs on the Pi. Let's go ahead and go into the next step. Let's get physical. Okay, I'm not really a good singer, but that's a throwback for my friends here that know that one. All right, here we go. Now let's think about exploring physical computing by building a simple circuit using the Raspberry Pi. We'll control an output utilizing Scratch and see how we can get more complex, thanks Melissa, with Python. Are we ready? Let's dive in. All right, so we're gonna bring our code to life. All right, here we go. So we're gonna connect to digital computing. Let's take a look at this. Remember, it's all about having that first attempt in learning. So before I just showed you the parts pack, let's look at what really goes in there. In order for you to really engage your students with the Raspberry Pi, it's so much more than just hooking it up to the monitor, right? Thanks. Yes, Freddie, Yolanda, a concert in coding. So let's take a look at what some of the things are going in there. Now, I'm going to do my best to read through it because I think it's important for us to articulate what's included. You have a couple of different ohm resistors, the 4.7 and the 330. You have the 1UF electrolytic capacitor. You have a tactile button. I'm kind of hovering over that here, right? You have a half-size breadboard. We're going to talk about the breadboard in just a minute. You have a buzzer. You have a Pi GPIO pin reference board. That's the general purpose input output pin labeler. Without that, you may not know which any of those pins are, right? You have the LDR photo resistor. You have the screw terminal block. You have a host of male, female, male, male, and female, female jumper cables. In addition to that, you have a PIR sensor and a host of LEDs, right? Let's take a look at when we unpack it, what that looks like. So when we're thinking about working with the Raspberry Pi and the various projects we'll engage, one of those types of projects might require for us to utilize different types of cables, right? Different levels of ohm resistors. So it's important to be familiar with some of the anatomy of the different tools you'll be working with. Now, when we say anatomy, I think it's an interesting, because if you've ever wondered, how do I know when looking at an LED? How do I know when looking at a capacitor, right? Or a buzzer? What is the polarity? How do I know if it's positive or negative? Well, if you look at the screen, you'll notice that the longer end of the LED, the buzzer, the capacitor, is the positive end. It's an easy way of seeing which side is the positive and which side is the negative as you're preparing to orient them as you work with them on your different projects. I hope that makes sense. All right. Now, I want us to spend some time understanding about the resistors. Remember, they're not polarized. I'm saying that to say, as we dive into this a little bit further, I used to spend so much time trying to figure out if my resistor was oriented properly when I didn't have a physical computing project work properly. Come to find out, the orientation of the resistor has no impact. But having the correct resistor does have an impact, right? All right. So here in our kit, remember, you'd have 330 and 4.75 ohm resistors. And they give you some information about the coloring of the stripes to know which ones you're working with. All right. So a little bit more about the GPIO pin. General purpose, input, output. Let's go through the bullet points here. There are 40 of them, but some of them do have special uses, like being a specific voltage or being a ground, right? Some, like pins 2 and 3, have special properties. The numbers are not in order. The pins that are truly general purpose are 17, 18, 22, 23, 24, etc., right? You want to stick with them at first. That's how you can make sure you're learning how you can change them from being inputs or outputs or navigating into different functions as you're working with them and if your program is actually working as intended. And you want to make sure you do not connect motors or 5-volt devices like Arduinos to the GPIO pins. All right. So I know we're looking here at the screen, and I know that we have a little bit of information here to kind of support us as we're evaluating the GPIO pin. Now, this year is a challenge. Don't know if anyone would want to chime in. Right now, we want to begin by looking at the GPIO reference board. We know that the 3-volt pin would be the 3V3. I'm going to see if I can open up Annotate and kind of put a little mark right there. Boop. There we go, right? We want to identify the ground pin. Now, there are several ground pins. Let's see if we can use a different color. All right. There are several ground pins. One of the things as you begin working with the Raspberry Pi is, excuse me, becoming familiar with the different placement that you'll use your jumper cables. You'll find that each one of these ground pins that we're going to be working with on a different project really doesn't matter. Additionally, you'll find that not only are they equivalent, but once you learn more about controlling the GPIO pins, that's the general purpose input output pins, such as pin 17, you find that you can use any of the pins. All you'll have to do is make a slight change in the pin you're referencing or the command that you're giving in your program to get it to do what you want it to do. I'm going to clear this now. Clear all drawings. Thank you. Thank you. Feel free to chime in if you have any questions. We're just going through this now. All right. Now, here's a great, interesting, the breadboard. It's not for bread, but really, it's a way of you beginning to look at how you'll engage with the Raspberry Pi. Let's spend a few moments really understanding what we're looking at. I used to spend so much time thinking that when I looked at a specific schematic given of a project, that everything had to be aligned in the perfect orientation in order for my physical computing project to work. I was wrong. Let me show you why. When you look at the inside of the breadboard, you see the rails and the bars are all connected. No matter if you put it in the first area or later down the row, you're getting the same polarity. It will do the same thing whether it's here or down here. However, you want to make sure you're looking to that line, right? Because that is how you know whether or not it will be giving you the desired placement, right? Not so much the specific number it's in. So when you see a project like this here, this is just an example, right? The truth of whether or not your project will work will be based on whether or not you have it oriented properly in the correct rail and bar, but not the specific number rail or bar. Let me show you why. When you look at how it is designed, this piece here is what connects that whole area, right? This is going to be inside of the actual breadboard. So when you're looking at having something placed on a rail or on a bar, it does not matter. And I think it may be particularly helpful for your students as well. Once they get that out of their heads, it'll get them more focused on the actual project than the placement of their specific jumper cable, as long as it is placed in the proper segment to get the desired polarity, if that makes sense. All right, let's keep going. So let's build something. You know, a lot of times when we're thinking about bringing these things together, I know we had a little fun with the Raspberry Pi. We had a little bit of coding, but what else can we do with this, right? Let's go ahead and grab out a couple of pieces. I know we may not have them with us. So let's just say it were a female to female jumper cable. Excuse me. This appears to be a female to male jumper cable, two colors. And I think that needs to be corrected on this slide. So if you're looking at this slide 41, if we look at what's actually on the screen, it appears that this is a female to a male jumper cable, two of those. Okay, I'll have to make that change, but we're going to continue going. An LED, a resistor, right? You're going to need your breadboard. All right, let's take a look here. We're going to begin by looking at this sample circuit, right? And in lieu of a couple of pieces, let's say the Raspberry Pi, let's say our power source, right? We're going to create a circuit and we're going to light an LED. Oh my. So what we would do in this case is we would take a, you know what, looking at this design here, it is two female to female, excuse me. It's just that the schematic showed the female. I need to change the picture, not the labeling. Because if we look here, we have a female going onto the 3-volt 3 and a female going to the positive end of the LED. And we have the female jumper cable going to the shorter end of the LED to the resistor, right? And the female end of the other jumper cable to the other end of the resistor, to the female end of the jumper cable onto the ground of the GPIO pin on the Raspberry Pi. All right. Now that sounds rather complex, but really it's rather simple when you look at the graphic. Just fun saying those different cables and orientations. All right. So once doing that, oh my goodness, we've just lit up an LED. And this is really can be a eureka moment. So the wondering is, if you were thinking about your classroom and you're thinking about your students, right? I remember before I said this introductory lesson here with the Scratch program may be something you choose to do or not choose to do. Let's take a look at why. Because now you're going to go into Scratch and you're going to add on the Pi GPIO, right? Under the more block. And now you're going to get physical. And you're going to build something by now creating a blinking LED utilizing Scratch, right? So with the GPIO now added as a more block, right, your students can look at this and now design a program in Scratch that can allow them to blink an LED. Would anyone like to take a stab at how they would organize these blocks if they were wanting to flash an LED? Any takers?
I can.
Oh, awesome.
I'd put the forever loop under the flag.
Uh-huh.
And then I'd put the weight in between my two gray blocks. I'd always put also put one like after it so that it wow. like waits in between each thing. So it goes off and on for the same amount of time.
Wow.
And put that all in the forever loop.
Let's take a look. That is an example of exactly how they would do it. You would think you were looking at the exact program. And now the interesting thing here, though, is everyone is that you can totally iterate upon this by looking at different GPIO pins that you can challenge or innovate or add or shift. It doesn't have to be 17. It can be a myriad of them as you begin to learn how to interact and engage the different pins. Now, let's take this same project, right? Remember, now that you have had your students maybe engage in that introductory lesson, had them now engage in a activity where they've lit the LED, now they blink the LED in Scratch, let's take a look at what that might look like in Python. Now, the cool thing about the Raspberry Pi is that it has an embedded program called Thonny. Thonny we can call it Python Junior, right? Because it's a great platform to learn how to program and to get support when you're not necessarily maybe getting your program right. If you make an error, it will spit out to you directly in the shell below what your error is and even highlight for you what blocks or line you might want to look at in order for you to be able to think about what you might want to change. It might even give you suggestions such as different reference libraries for you to pull from in order for you to be able to make sure that your program is functioning properly. It's so fun. So similarly, we're going to blink, but we're now going to extend, right? We've now enhanced our program. We've now went from just lighting the LED to looking at creating a blinking LED. So we've given the students a chance to look at this schematic, right? We've given them a chance to redesign their program, redesign and orient their hardware. I want to use my terms specifically here. And as they do that, they're becoming familiar with a little bit of what we were talking about before. Remember the rails and the bars piece? This is where that becomes particularly helpful. So as an example, it would make no difference whether the student placed the 3-volt jumper cable into A, B, C, or D. Does that make sense? Spending so much time making sure it's in C wouldn't make a difference, right? Similarly with the ground. It could go into, what letters is that? F, G, or I, or J, theoretically, right? It wouldn't matter because those rails and bars are connected. All right, I hope that makes sense. All right, let's go ahead and proceed. So here's an example of blinking your LED. So we would give the students an opportunity to draft this code in Python. For some students, this may be their first exposure to writing an actual program outside of a block space. And this will be an opportunity for them to discover a little bit of how that works. So from GPIO, import LED, from time, import sleep, right? And then we'll give them a challenge after they have had a chance to draft that, right? Can you add another LED light? Determine what these commands do and give them a chance to spend some time with that. And to work together and talk amongst their team about how they would respond to one of these challenges. So in case you're wondering, gee, that was pretty interesting, but how do they differ? Let's take a look at it here. On the left, we have Scratch. On the right, we have Python, Thonny. I'm curious, what are your thoughts as you evaluate the differences in these two programs? What might be some things you wonder or consider as you look at how your students might respond to engaging either?
I'm always amazed that students realize that they know more than they think they do when it comes time to write a language once they've been programming in blocks.
Wow, that's awesome. And here's the thing, I've had students respond, see, I knew I could do real coding. We're like, wow. Wow, that's so validating there, because if I'm honest, I am an ambassador for Girls Who Code. And one of the most interesting things that I have had as an experience has been to have folks that maybe didn't see themselves in a space, achieve in a space, and now see themselves as now belonging there. They've released that imposter syndrome. And I think that's what happens as we give students an opportunity to engage with these types of learning experiences. So let's kind of see what we're doing there, right? So what we're doing is we're understanding that when we're importing and we're including these different frames, we are indicating that when we use a pound or hashtag or a number sign, have to say all three, right? We are adding a comment, right? When we're importing, we are bringing in pre-written modules. So that speaks to the idea of the modularity within programming, right? When we are saying while true, we are creating a forever loop, right? And there's loads of resources for you to look at as you think about ways you can support your students. Also, while we may not get into this depth with our students, this is a level of abstraction, hiding unnecessary details to make a concept easier to grasp, right? So this here is an example of an electrical schematic diagram that abstracts away most of the physical details of circuit construction. If I'm honest, looking at the right is foreign to me. This narrative helps me to communicate what we're seeing, because that may look like something I would not know how to communicate if I saw that and didn't know that this was basically communicating the same thing that we're having on the left, right? All right. Again, hardware abstraction. You know, we engage these types of programs every day, driving down the street, at a red light, at a stop sign, at a walking sign, right? How might we abstract? How might we give students to innovate? So here's a chance to look at a code. Melissa and I were joking about this earlier, in that sometimes you can see a code and you think you know how it's supposed to go. But then when given the pressure of the moment, amongst all my friends here now, Julie and Yolanda and Marsha and Melissa, and I know someone else joined, I don't see their name right now, I apologize, that I may not recall it properly, but if we were practicing together, right, this is a safe space, we see it's red on, sleep three, red off. It then goes sleep three, yellow on. What would come next? We have any brave souls here?
Doesn't red come after yellow?
Red does come after yellow. Let's see here. Red, sleep, red, sleep, yellow. That's a wondering. Does anyone else have any ideas on this? I'm curious. Here's Yolanda.
Would sleep yellow be next?
Right. Sleep three, then yellow. Which? So we've got yellow on, sleep three, yellow, I guess we'll say off. And then we'll be next would be, I guess, sleep three. And then green dot on. Sleep three, green off, I'm thinking, would get us through the whole cycle. I don't know. Thoughts?
That sounds correct.
All right. Well, here's the thing. We could actually enter that, right? And that's the cool thing about the whole program is you'll get a chance to see it in two places. When you run this in Thani, if it executes properly and you don't get an error code, but it doesn't translate to what you're seeing on your actual physical computing project, that's when you know you need to look to your orientation of your rails and your bars, of your LEDs and resistors within the rails and bars and where your jumper cables are placed. I hope that makes sense. All right. Well, hey, listen, it's all about abstracting. There's loads of built-in libraries. I encourage you to take a look at the website where the CS for All teacher community will post this presentation and resources in order for you to be able to understand more about how we, print statements are your friend here for isolating logic errors versus coding errors. Absolutely. Thank you, Julie. All right. So again, there's loads of opportunities for greater thought and prompts as you're reviewing the content. I definitely think it's important for you to consider where you'll go with what we've learned. There's loads of projects for you to consider. I encourage you to visit the Raspberry Pi project page, where you can take a look at all different types of projects. So Julie, earlier when we were talking, you mentioned games. You can go right and search for games. Maybe you wanna create a website. Maybe you wanna do something with music. Maybe you wanna build a robot or do digital art. All of those are options to you, right? On the page, right there, you can click, let me close this window here, I'm sorry. Let me close this window here, this one here too. On the page, you can see there's loads of projects, and you can even select by any type of hardware. Here we can select Raspberry Pi, but look at what else they have there, right? A micro:bit 3D printer, any software, right? So depending upon what you want to do, there's loads of options there for you. Let's say you selected Raspberry Pi. This would take you to a host of projects that you could take a look at to consider to engage your students with. And I think that's an awesome opportunity to continue the learning and the utilization of the resources there. Now, you want to make sure you shut it down properly when you're done. Really quickly here, I want to make sure I share this. I recently, as part of our OC Maker project, had to come up with a new way, and we utilized a learning management system. This here is an organization of how we broke down a little bit of what we went through in a module on Canvas. You could use Blackboard or Google Classroom. But this gave us a way to give students an opportunity to engage with the Raspberry Pi remotely, right? Getting started with the Raspberry Pi, connecting their parts, looking at installing software, engaging in coding time, all the same things we engaged in. So I invite you to take a look at the website for the Raspberry Pi resources, to take a look at the project page, and even consider joining an online course where you can have access to free professional learning and community around the Raspberry Pi. Maybe even consider starting up a code club at your school. Again, while you don't have to have a Raspberry Pi, it's a great way for you to engage learners in physical computing. I want to thank you for joining me today for this amazing jam-packed hour of exploring all the great things we can do, exploration and discovery with the Raspberry Pi, the little computer that can. Might anyone have any questions? Oh, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Thanks so much for joining us today. It was so much fun to be able to share, and we were able to get through all of the slides, and hopefully everyone found this of value. And please do take a look at the CS for All Teachers website, where you'll be able to find access to this presentation, as well as a copy of the video of what we've talked about today. Please do stay tuned. We have a host of webinars coming up in March and April, all about building community and sharing up great CS resources. And it has been my honor to share with you today. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you so much, Omar. This has indeed been incredible. I placed a link in the chat box there, and that's a link to tonight's event post on the CS for All Teachers community, and that is where we will share the PowerPoint deck as well as the recording. As Omar mentioned, it usually takes us a day or two to get that information up there, and then we usually also tweet it out. So you, if you're following us on Twitter or a member of the community, you should see and have access to that information. But we thank you so much. There will be additional webinars to be posted soon. We're just finalizing a few dates for our other ambassadors and guests. So we just thank you so much and hope that you all have a great evening. Take care, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.